Welcome back, everyone. Bea here. Do you read the nutrition labels on packages of food when you're deciding what to eat? It's important to do, but wow, there's a lot of information here. We already learned that calories are the amount of chemical energy available in a serving of the food, but what about the rest of these rows? Let's look at carbohydrates. There are 34 grams of carbs in a serving of this food, but carbohydrates also have subcategories listed below, fiber and sugars. But those two numbers don't add up to the total carbohydrate value. What does all of this mean? How can I tell what kind of molecules are in this food, and how do I know if it's healthy or not? A nutrition label makes a lot more sense if you know what macromolecules are. Let's explore macromolecules in more detail so we can demystify nutrition labels once and for all. By the end of this lesson, you'll be able to characterize biological macromolecules, describe the structure and function of simple sugars, and describe the structure and function of polysaccharides. First things first, what is a macromolecule? The prefix macro means large, so the name tells us that macromolecules are large molecules. But large is relative. As we'll see through the lesson, some macromolecules are much larger than others. And because the atoms they're made of are so small, even large macromolecules are invisible to the naked eye. Can you guess which element forms the backbone of macromolecules? I'll give you a hint. It's an element that can form strong bonds with up to four other atoms. Carbon. Carbon is the only element capable of providing the structure for large, complex macromolecules. Because they are carbon-based, macromolecules are organic molecules. But carbon is not the only element included in these biological structures. We'll find lots of hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, and phosphorus sprinkled in as well. Not all macromolecules are biological, meaning they come from or exist in living things. For example, plastics are composed of macromolecules. However, in the next few lessons, we will focus specifically on three categories of biological macromolecules: carbohydrates, lipids, and proteins. We'll learn more about the fourth category of macromolecules, nucleic acids, in Unit 5. Let's jump in today with carbohydrates, starting with simple sugars. Carbohydrates are macromolecules consisting specifically of carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen atoms. This is glucose, a carbohydrate with the chemical formula C6H12O6. Notice the black carbons, white hydrogens, and red oxygens. Carbon forms most of the central ring structure. Carbohydrates are also known as saccharides. Glucose is a monosaccharide because it consists of one saccharide unit. Another monosaccharide is fructose. Notice how similar these two monosaccharides are. They even have the same chemical formula. The atoms are just arranged a little differently. Not all carbohydrates are monosaccharides, though. Two monosaccharides can bond together to form a disaccharide. For example, a glucose ring linked to a fructose ring forms sucrose, the sugar you may have in your kitchen cabinet for baking. Monosaccharides like glucose and fructose and disaccharides, like sucrose, are classified as simple sugars. Plants use energy from the sun to produce these simple sugars through photosynthesis. The molecules are a source of chemical energy and have a sweet taste. When the plants or animals that eat the plants break down simple sugars, energy is released that the organism uses to function. Do you notice a pattern in the names of these simple sugars? They all end with the suffix -ose. Other simple sugars, including lactose and maltose, also end with this suffix. If you see the name of a molecule which ends in -ose, you can tell right away that it is a carbohydrate. We already saw in our lesson about water that sucrose dissolves in water. Good thing, too, because otherwise we couldn't make lemonade. Do you remember why this happens? Because both water and sucrose are polar molecules, meaning they have charged regions. When crystals of sucrose are mixed into water, the charged regions of water molecules are attracted to the charged regions of sucrose molecules, surrounding them and separating the sucrose molecules from each other. In both water and sucrose, the polarity results from oxygen and hydrogen atoms bonded together. When oxygen bonds to hydrogen, the oxygen side ends up with a partial negative charge and the hydrogen side with a partial positive charge. If we look at other simple sugar molecules, we'll find that they all contain oxygen-hydrogen bonds. This means that all simple sugars are polar and that they all dissolve in water. This allows sugars to dissolve in water-based fluids like sap and blood, where they can be transported to all of an organism's tissues to provide energy. Some animals, including humans, can sneak sap from trees as an energy source for themselves. That's where real maple syrup comes from. Yum! Okay, let's return to our nutrition label to see if it makes any more sense now. There are 34 grams of carbohydrates in a serving of this food, and 5 grams of that is simple sugars, like the ones we just discussed. 4 of the 5 grams were added by the food manufacturer, meaning that 1 gram of simple sugars occurred naturally in the food. But what about this other category listed below carbohydrates? Fiber. And why don't the subcategories add up to the total carbohydrates value? Well, it turns out that not all carbohydrates are simple sugars. To simplify our carbohydrate models, we can replace the sugar rings with hexagons. We'll need that simplification to show carbohydrates made of many monosaccharides bonded together, called polysaccharides. Polysaccharides consist of hundreds or even thousands of glucose rings bonded together in various shapes. One example is starch, which consists of anywhere from 300 to 1,000 glucose monosaccharides linked together. Plants assemble some of the simple sugars that they produce into starch for storage. Starch has some branched regions and some coiled regions, as shown. Plants and the animals that eat them can break the glucose units in starch apart to use for energy. Animals also store extra glucose that they consume in the form of a polysaccharide, but not starch. Instead, animals form glycogen, another branched polysaccharide made of thousands of glucose rings bonded together. Glycogen is assembled and stored in the liver and muscles and is broken down when the animal needs energy. There is another polysaccharide which serves a structural role rather than an energy storage role. It's called cellulose. And like starch, it is produced by plants. It is also formed from thousands of glucose rings bonded together in straight chains. The shape of cellulose molecules allows them to stack on top of each other, as shown, forming a rigid structure. Cellulose provides rigidity to tough plant materials like celery and wood. But it's not just the straight shape of cellulose chains that gives it a tough structure. Earlier, we discussed how simple sugars, including glucose, are polar molecules because of their many oxygen-hydrogen bonds. Cellulose chains are made of thousands of glucose rings, so they have lots of these polar regions. When one cellulose chain lines up next to another one, the positive hydrogen regions on one chain are attracted to the negative oxygen regions on another. This holds the chains together and creates tough fibers. In plants, individual cellulose chains combine this way to form durable fibers. These fibers make up plants' cell walls and give them structure. As you'll learn in more detail in Unit 3, animal cells do not have cell walls like plant cells do. Though we may not produce cellulose, we animals do consume cellulose when we eat plants. And unlike starch, humans are not able to break down cellulose molecules. This means we cannot get energy from it. Cellulose passes through our digestive tracts and comes out the other end. Because it doesn't provide us with energy, it may seem like eating cellulose is pointless and offers us no benefit. But that couldn't be farther from the truth. Cellulose is a form of fiber. Fiber is an essential part of our diets because it helps move waste through our digestive systems properly. Fiber also slows down the digestion process, so simple sugars from food are absorbed more slowly and do not cause blood sugar spikes. Additionally, fiber helps lower bad cholesterol in the blood and increase good bacteria in the intestines. For all of these reasons, cellulose and other forms of fiber are important in our diets. Despite its many benefits, it is estimated that 95% of Americans do not consume enough fiber. You can make sure you get enough fiber by eating lots of vegetables, fruits, whole grains, and nuts. Diets high in fiber are associated with a lower risk of many diseases, including heart disease and diabetes. Back to your nutrition label. Can we figure out the rest of the carbohydrate information now? Well, we already discovered that sugars refer to the simple sugars, which are monosaccharides and disaccharides, like glucose, fructose, and sucrose. We now know that fiber consists of polysaccharides, like cellulose, that our body can't digest but serve important roles as they pass through the digestive system. But 5 grams of sugar plus 7 grams of fiber doesn't add up to 34 grams of total carbohydrates. Any ideas what the rest of the carbohydrates are? They're starch, the other polysaccharide produced by plants. Our bodies can break apart the glucose units in starch and use them for energy. However, it takes more time than absorbing the ready-to-use simple sugars, so starches are a more slowly released form of energy. Subtracting the 5 grams of sugar and 7 grams of fiber from 34 tells us that there are 22 grams of starch per serving of this food. You may have heard that carbs are bad for you. After this lesson, it should be clear that this is an oversimplification. Carbohydrates are the main molecular energy source in our bodies. And since we can't make our own sugars like plants do, we must eat them. And indigestible polysaccharides, like cellulose, act as fiber and are key for keeping our bodies healthy. So, carbohydrates themselves are not bad. They are essential molecules of life. However, it is true that excessive carbohydrate consumption, especially simple sugars, has become a problem for a lot of people. The widespread availability of heavily sweetened foods like candy, donuts, and soda leads many to consume far more sugar than they need, leading to health problems like obesity and diabetes. Furthermore, many healthy foods that were originally healthy are now processed to remove fiber and add more sugars. For example, whole grains are excellent sources of fiber and provide a healthy amount of simple sugars. But when whole grains are processed to make refined grains like white flour, almost all of the fiber is removed. Additionally, more sugar is often added to refined products to make them sweeter. The problem is not carbohydrates themselves, but rather an imbalance in the types of carbohydrates being consumed. The key is to keep simple sugar consumption below a healthy level and to consume enough fiber. When properly balanced, carbohydrates are our friend. We now know that biological macromolecules are large organic molecules which allow organisms to function. That simple sugar carbohydrates include monosaccharides and disaccharides and are quick sources of energy. And that polysaccharide carbohydrates can provide energy storage, structure, and fiber. In the next lesson, we'll dig deeper into our nutrition label as we look at another category of macromolecules, lipids. Until then, remember, biology is more than just science. It's the way of life.